A newly developed anomalous parasite has recently been found in the blood of several individuals in multiple major cities of Australia. Less than 48 hours afterwards, this novel parasitic worm was discovered in almost all nations on Earth, signifying that this disease either spreads at an incredible pace or was somehow avoiding human detection for enough time to extend throughout the globe. The parasite is a roundworm, dubbed Neurophagus cognitophid, also known to the commoner as mind maggots. This worm infiltrates the human brain and drastically affects behavior. First, in simple, indirect ways, like manipulating hormones, the patient becomes more reclusive and aggressive. In the first few days of infection, this could be seen as just a bad mood. But as it progresses, the individual gets more paranoid about other people. Eventually, they avoid human contact completely and will often take to barricading themselves in a small, dark room. At this stage, if caught, the infestation can be cured with a new medical treatment known as pulling a fucking worm out of their head. Although, this is made incredibly difficult because the individual avoids human intervention at all costs. Also disturbing about this parasitic roundworm is that upon further investigation, the organism appears to be man-made. A chimera abomination featuring the DNA of several different organisms, including parasitic roundworms, tapeworms, pinworms, flatworms, leeches, several species of annelids, and strangest of all, a series of jawless fish, most heavily the lamprey. While this screams intelligent intervention, no suspects have been identified to date. But I'm just gonna keep electrocuting random biology doctorates until I find out who did it. At first, the worm only affects behavior, causing the individual to become erratic and aggressive around people. They retreat to an isolated, damp, dark area so the infestation can progress. Slowly, the worm grows by feeding on the host's tissue, and when ready, it travels to the brain and begins to metamorphosis into an adult.
They grow up so fast. I'm not crying, you're crying for you.
The adult form of this parasite is more along the lines of a beetle. After it gradsturbates from pupa, the specimen begins to consume the human brain, resulting in even more erratic behavior. At this stage, there has never been a successful attempt at removing the parasite without killing the patient.
I mean, we got it out, but he's dead as shit, man.
The beetle then hooks into the nervous system of the host, taking the place of the brain, leaving the former human being no more. The next stage of the disease is the most unsettling so far.
And I just told you the part where a beetle eats someone's fucking brain, so that's saying something.
The beetle dislodges from the nervous system of the individual, which results in them collapsing. It travels out of the empty skull and down the spine. The visuals for this are unsettling, to say the least. An alien lump under the skin that moves with an unnerving scuttle. The beetle's legs writhe underneath the epidermis, resulting in a repeated sickening squelch of wet flesh as it travels all the way to the base of the tailbone.
From the poo hole to the brain, it lays a massive cluster of eggs.
A grotesque lump that encompasses the entirety of the spine and spinal cord.
Nature is just so beautiful sometimes. I mean, not right now. This makes me want to set fire to the entirety of Yellowstone National Park, but I don't know, watch a horse give birth or something.
After laying the eggs, the beetle returns to the empty skull cavity, and the individual reawakens.
However, they reawaken paralyzed.
For several days, the former person lays on the ground as the beetle fuses with the spinal cord, after which, the eggs begin to hatch. Thousands of worms begin to consume the entirety of the host, other than their external features and the most vital of organs.
The worms are plastic and elastic like muscle, and are capable of transmitting impulses.
They use their nature to replace the entirety of the musculature and nervous system. They connect to their mother and give a more nuanced and complete control of the body to the beetle.
A family that consumes a host together stays together.
It is at this point that the movements and behaviors become incredibly difficult to detect as uncanny. Although, if one looks close enough at a host, they'll notice a nauseating wriggling under the skin, where the worms writhe to move the body.
While this might sound horrifying, I bet $100 at least one of you finished to that sentence.
The blood, saliva, urine, even the air in the lungs become saturated with the eggs of these creatures, making these nests a walking terminal of transmission vectors.
Speaking of disease transmission vectors, what makes this parasite so threatening is that it has the capacity to spread from person to person via almost any known means.
The eggs are light and hardy enough to travel on air.
The parasites are right at home in almost any fluid.
When introduced to a biologically active body of water like a pond, lake, or ocean, the worms will hatch and possibly due to their lamprey ancestry, they can survive indefinitely by consuming the blood of other creatures in the water. However, they've only shown to take root in human hosts, which they actively seek the second they spring from their weird squishy frog eggs. If you thought that shit was gross and horrifying, just wait until you see the ramifications of a completed infection. Eventually, when a population has been saturated enough with these hosts, the hosts will begin to congregate. The beetles release pheromones, attracting all other worm hives in the area. The worms restructure the physiology of their hosts. The top of the skull fractures with a sickening crunch and opens from the middle of the chin like a Venus flytrap. What was once the beetle matriarch, in its extended stay, fused with the host neurology. It has swollen to the size of the brain it consumed, its limbs atrophied, and the being left was nothing more than a pulsating mass of softened exoskeleton. The worms begin to eat the skin that kept them together, dissolving the body and cradling their matriarchs to the ground slowly. The worms then carry their beetles to an isolated area en masse, devouring any living thing they come across. Once they find a suitable place, they spin a large cocoon that has a fleshy consistency, and it immediately fills with fluid. Human authorities are quick to dispatch any of these on site, as this looks, to use the scientific term, like you're absolutely fucked. Because of this shoot first, ask questions later attitude, there has never been any observed parasite activity past this. However, when human researchers examined the material from the popped flesh bubble, it looked as though a massive, undeveloped arthropod was suspended in the cocoon. Almost like it was gestating.
Oh boy, wow, I sure wonder what would happen if it finished gestating. If you wonder that too, you should like, comment, and subscribe with all notifications enabled, or I'll fill you with fucking worms! I wanna shout out Dead Rex for making these spooky critters. Shout out the Inner Circle. Love y'all.
Three brains!